Bismillah, walhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalam upon all the messengers of Allah. My dear sisters and my brothers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, and welcome back to part number 2 about the knowledge of Allah. And also what Allah has written, and basically is to deal with the comprehensive understanding of the term al-qadr. Because there is a qadr that the Qur'an talks about, and the other qadr is what everybody knows out there, that is actually formulated in hadith, and the two contradict with each other, and this talk is to actually illuminate and highlight the differences so that you actually get the right idea about what Allah wants to say to us when He says that everything was created due to qadr. But before moving any further up, one thing that has that kept creeping back and coming back is your reaction to Allah not knowing the future. And many of you have said that you find it extremely difficult to believe that Allah doesn't know the future, and you deal with this differently. First of all, let me say this. I don't blame you for the way you believe right now. Because the way you believe is not, you have not taken the time to deduct the Islam in which you believe from the Quran, but rather you heard it from XYZ and you heard it from a hadith and the sheikh, and you made the biggest error, like I have at one point in my life, like a lot of people are still making, have always made, and they will always make this error, even though Allah warned us not to do it, is to trust people who appoint themselves as scholars and people that speak on behalf of Allah, just like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had warned us against the rabbi and the priests and also the sheikhs and scholars. But what did we do? We did exactly as he said we shouldn't have done. Instead of listening to the Quran, we went and trusted the sheikhs and everything, and here we are today, head against the wall. I will take a little bit of time to highlight this issue about Allah and the future. I have already promised that I will cover the whole talk together. But it's just your impatience and the amount of questions and that kind of stuff. So I felt like I will give you like 3 ways on how Allah talks to us in Al-Quran, and how we, subhanAllah, Allah talks to us in Al-Quran deliberately, openly, clearly, concisely, and you can put anything out there that means that the point gets to you. But for whatever reason, we still don't understand from Allah what He wants to tell us. And when I come to you and say that Allah doesn't know the future, He knows the unseen, and this is complete different ball game. The unseen is something that exists now or has existed in the past. But the unseen does not mean things that have not existed, because that's the future. And this is explained in Al-Quran, but let me give you 3 examples, because I don't want to spend too much time about this topic, but in the future I'm going to cover it up. The very first one of these, as I said, hundreds of those arguments, but I'm just going to spend yet 3 of them. The first one is when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks to us about our father Adam. Now, it is a general understanding in the Muslim or the believer, because you see, Allah, ilaha illallah. When I say Muslim, I don't mean you and I who believe in the Quran, the Prophet Muhammad, because a Muslim is anyone that came after Ibrahim and before Ibrahim that believes in a messenger. Ibrahim named, alayhi salam, named us Muslims, and that's why we are called the Muslim. Are the Jews Muslims? Of course they are. Are the Christian Muslims? Of course they are. You and I who believe in the Quran and the Prophet Muhammad and all the messengers, of course we are Muslims. You see, the Jewish are Muslims minus 2. They don't believe in Jesus and they don't believe in Muhammad. The Christians, they are Muslims minus 1, is they don't believe, and they believe in Jesus, they don't believe in Muhammad. We believe in all the messengers, either named or not named. But for this talk's sake, I'm going to use the term Muslim. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks to us in Al-Quran about our father Adam. And as I said, the majority of, if not the totality of Muslims today, believe that Adam is the first man that Allah created. The Qur'an does not say this. The Qur'an says that Adam as a creature, as a species, comes from a long chain of that species that has existed from before him. But Adam, with Adam, Allah broke the chain of that species from what he was to what we are today. The breakage that took place is Adam. And I will explain this, inshallah, when I deal with the issue of the Adam's creation. But for now, Allah talks to us about a very particular thing in Adam's life. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Taha, that is Surah number 20, and this ayah is 115. Allah says, وَلَقَدْ عَهِدْنَا إِلَىٰ آدَمَ مِنْ قَبْلِ. And we had given a directive, instruction to Adam earlier on, before. What was that instruction? Well, that instruction is that the shaitan is a sworn enemy to Adam, his partner, to his progeny, and that Adam, under any circumstances, whatever the cost, he must never ever listen to a shaitan, nor follow his advices, ideas, or directives, or anything. Okay, why? Allah has explained in the Quran, and I will deal with this later on when I speak about Allah in the future. But what did Adam do? The entire opposite of what Allah expected from him. Allah said, don't do it. Adam went ahead and did the opposite. Now, despite all warnings and threats from Allah, and even Allah told him, Adam, you are in the Jannah. If you obey me and you don't approach that tree, nothing ever will happen to you. You'll never get hungry, you'll never get thirsty, you'll never get cold, you'll never get tired, and the list goes on. Okay? But Allah, the retrospect, told him, if you approach that tree, then you're going to get hungry, tired, and what you are on earth today enduring. So Adam, what he did, alayhi salam, he didn't uphold his part of the bargain. And that's why we are on earth today. We are on earth because our leader did not uphold his bargain, and we are on earth for a period of time. And our goal is to go back to where we once were, paradise. This is why Allah says, وَلَقَدْ عَهِدْنَا إِلَىٰ آدَمَ مِنْ قَبْلِ. And we had given directive to Adam earlier on. We gave him clear instruction. What did Adam do? He forgot. And then here is what Allah tells us. So Allah was disappointed in Adam. Allah had all hopes, he had high hopes in this creature, this species that Allah had used to break what he was before to what he was going to become. That Allah gave him special gifts. He had given him the brain. Okay, the brains, and he gave us a lot of things, and Allah had high hopes that Adam would perform very well. Then Allah felt disappointed, and he said that Adam, he forgot. And then he said, وَلَمْ نَجِدْ لَهُ عَزْمًا. And we did not find in Adam a firm resolve. He was not resilient. He had nothing of that. Now the question to ask is, because of those people that say that Allah had written everything and knows the future, if Allah knew that Adam couldn't keep up his part of the deal and that he would eat from the tree, why didn't Allah do anything to help Adam not fall in the traps of shaitan? Because Adam could have turned to Allah and said, Ya Allah, you knew I was not able to carry this message. Why didn't you help me against shaitan? No. Adam exactly understood, and as I said in my previous talk, that Adam and every other messenger that ever walked earth, this came as a part of the package that Allah knows the seen and the unseen, but doesn't know the future. The future, you are all alone. That's why there is a judgment day. The judgment day is there to hold us accountable for the choices we made. We cannot on judgment day tell you to Allah, yeah, Allah, you knew and you didn't do, because Allah is going to say, I didn't say I know the future. What are you going to tell him? Bukhari said, the scholars say, when Allah tells you, I've said in Al-Quran that I don't know the future, why didn't you read my book? Now, here is the second element of this thing here, to keep it short, yeah? Allah, when Allah sent Musa to Fir'aun again, Allah had no idea, he didn't know if Fir'aun was going to accept the message of Musa or reject it. That's why Allah sent Musa, he equipped him with everything, and he gave him the evidences. Why did Allah send the evidences from him? So that Fir'aun knows that Musa is sent from Allah, and that the matter is serious. Okay, all what Allah wanted from Fir'aun, that he stops torturing the children of Israel and release them, let them go of Egypt. Simple, easy schmeasy peasy, just do that, right? Well, Allah sent those messages with Musa alayhi salam to help Fir'aun make the right decision. So, when Musa alayhi salam came to Fir'aun, what did Fir'aun do? How did he respond to that? Well, instead of believing, Fir'aun decided to go the other way. Watch what Allah felt, and I use the term feel, because Allah has emotions. Allah feels. That's why Allah loves. That's why Allah hates. That's why Allah plots. That's why Allah gets disappointed. That's why Allah gets angry. That's our, and the list goes on. Because these are emotions. This is why in Al-Quran he says that nothing looks like unto Allah. Because when I say feels, you might think that Allah's feeling is like yours and mine. No, I use the term feeling to convey the message to you. But Allah's feelings are completely different to yours and mine. But the outcome is the same. He loves. He hates. He gets angry. He plots. He manipulates. He does this and he does that. So, here is what Allah says about Fir'aun in the English. Okay, I'll deal with this in Arabic when I talk about the whole future and Allah issue in the future, inshallah. And Fir'aun, here is Musa, he came to him and he's got all the evidences. So here he's talking to Fir'aun. What did Fir'aun do? Well, Fir'aun called his own people, the government, the people around him. And Fir'aun here is making his plea. He wants people to be on his side. So he tells them, my people, does not the kingdom of Egypt belong to me? Egypt was a superpower at that time, rich and everything, right? So he uses that. It's like today the American president goes, am I not the president of the United States? In other words, he's the president of the world, so to speak. So Fir'aun is pushing here all his advantages to make people come to his side, because people could see that Moses could take the power away from Fir'aun. So this man tells them, am I not the king of Egypt and that the whole of Egypt belong to me? And these rivers flow in beneath me, because Egypt is in a desert land. So Fir'aun used the biggest asset that he had at that time, rivers. Just like today they use the petrol and they use all those fuel and all that kind of stuff. But anyhow, so, and then he said, can you not see? So he's trying to reinforce his case here. And then he said, am I not better than this? And he points to Musa alayhi salam, who is contemptible and can scarcely express himself clearly, because in front of Fir'aun, Musa was scared. Not that he had a problem with his, Musa had an issue when he's challenged and he gets emotional, he starts, like you when you're scared. If the police stop you, do you talk normal or do you start getting shaky and panicky and scared and then you start shaking? Well, that's exactly what happened to Musa alayhi salam. And then, when people were looking at that, and then he said, he can't even express himself properly. And then Fir'aun pushes furthermore. He goes, so why were the bracelets of gold not sent down to him? Because all he says is, he's got, because you see, Fir'aun is a man that believes in riches, gold and everything. And that's what matters to him. You bring a staff that turns into a snake, hey, it's magic. But if you bring gold, there is between me, I can see it. And then he says, or why did the angels not come along with him as companions? And if you remember what I said, before Allah used to send angels, people could see those angels, and not like in their wings and all, okay? But they had a special form, and people would know that these are angels. And at that time, when an angel comes with a human being, that is a reinforcement and a vouching from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that this man is from Allah. So Fir'aun is using the argument. Then he said, and then this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, thus he incited his people to absurdity, and they obeyed him. Fir'aun used those tricks to manipulate his people, but these people were people who would take advantages, like to their governments and everybody. So they went along with Fir'aun. And they obeyed him when they did that. Now Allah says, they surely were an immoral and perverse people. I.e. they were spineless people with no personality whatsoever. They didn't stand up with the truth. Then Allah reveals how he felt to us and how he did or what he did with that emotion. When he had that feeling, what did Allah do after that? And this one, I will read the Arabic because the Arabic is absolutely powerful. Allah says, فَلَمَّا أَسَفُونَا انتقمنا منهم فأغرقناهم أجمعين. This is in Surah Az-Zukhruf, that is Surah number 43, from Ayah 51 to 55. Asafuna in Arabic means grieved us, saddened us, sorrowed us, disappointed us. So what Allah is basically saying is this, and when they grieved us, when they saddened us, when they sorrowed us, when they disappointed us, what did we do? What did you do, Ya Allah? He goes, we revenged from them and drowned them all. So you see, Allah gets disappointed. Allah gets grieved. Allah gets saddened. Allah gets sorrowed. Allah feels, oh, like he said in Surah Yasin, but oh God, the Quran is so full of these things, okay? But why we don't accept to, why we don't say that? Even in our books of tafsir, in the Tabari, they say it clearly. They just don't use the term that Allah doesn't know the future, but they say everything else. Because you don't read the Quran properly and you rely on people to preach to you what Allah says. Exactly like the Christians, they don't read the Bible and they just trust the priest to tell them what's in the Bible. You're doing absolutely the same. I can't believe it that until today people still believe that the mother in Islam gets 3 times and the father gets 1. And they always tell you the mother gets 75% and the father gets 25% of the rest, respect, blah, 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 blah. The whole Middle East is built on this stupidity. When Allah in the Quran says, وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ حُسْنًا, and we have entrusted, we have given clear derivative to the human, to the person to take care of his both parents. In Islam, in the Quran, in the Islam of the Quran, it's 50-50%. Today, every book out there, mother, who is this Ya Rasulullah, mother, the Prophet would never utter such a lie. That's the price for ignoring the Quran. I just want to move to the argument number 3 again with Musa and Fir'aun. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَقَدْ أَهْلَكْنَا الْقُرُونَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَمَّا ظَلَمُوا. Allah talking to Quraysh after he told the story of Musa, Fir'aun, how he destroyed him. And then he turns to us and he tells us, and we had already destroyed generations before you when they transgressed. And their messengers had come to them with clear proofs. But they were not to believe these people were destroyed, so Allah destroyed them. And then Allah says, that's the way we recompense, we reward the criminal people. Then he drops upon us an atomic bomb defining the purpose of our existence from birth till death. And he said, ثُمَّ جَعَلْنَاكُمْ خَلَائِفَ فِي الْأَرْضِ مِنْ بَعْدِهِمْ. Then we made you their successors in the land after them. And he's talking to me. I am the successor of the generation that was before me. And the generation is going to come after me is going to be the successor of me, and so on and so forth, until the end of time. And then, why, Ya Allah, did you do all this? He says, لِنَنْظُرَ كَيْفَ تَعْمَلُونَ, so that we see how you would act. This is in Surah Yunus number 10, and the ayah is 13 and 14. How much do we want Allah to tell us that He doesn't know the future? That He doesn't know what humanity shall do until humanity actually does it. And then when they do it, He sees it, and then that act gets recorded, and guess what? It's trusted for judgment day. My brothers and my sisters, this is just a sample of hundreds of ayat in Al-Quran where Allah tells us that He doesn't know the future, that He is not responsible for what we're gonna do. Until we do it, it gets documented, then you'll be asked about on judgment day. But we refuse to accept what He says and rather believe in what the man-made hadiths and their guardians, i.e. sheikhs, scholars, and all these people who have dedicated to belie what Allah says. And even if He says it clear, they still reject it. That's why they invented this hugest lie that the Sunnah takes precedence over the Quran, that the Sunnah is the one that judges the Quran. And when a hadith contradicts the Quran, is the hadith that goes through. This is a knowledge that they call the knowledge that exists in our books. And that's the problem. The Quran is not. And the biggest lie is they tell you follow the book of Allah and the Sunnah of Rasulullah. They don't mean that at all. Well, how much would we want Allah to tell us, لِنَنْظُرَ كَيْفَ تَعْمَلُونَ, so that we see how you would act? What do we want Allah to just tell us, oh, by the way, I don't know the future. You guys deal with it. He said it. He said it in examples. He said it in wordings. He said it not once, not two times, not three times, not 10 times, not 20 times, not 30 times, not 50 times, not 100 times. And still people have problems believing in that. So my dear sisters, even in the book of Tabari and Umar ibn al-Khattab, many people, they actually say that Allah doesn't know the future. They don't say it the way I say it, like He doesn't know the future, but they say it directly, nicely, kindly. They tell you, you are here on earth, Allah is watching you and He's looking at you, and He is there to see how you are going to do, what you're going to do, and then He will judge you. Well, guess what? Exactly like He doesn't know the future. But they didn't use those terminologies because at their time, their knowledge was restricted. I guess it's enough for now just to set your mind at ease. But inshallah, when I deal with this issue, I will bring more and more and more and more and more and more evidences. Yani Yunus alayhi salam, the man who was swallowed by fish. Why did Allah do all that? It's because Yunus himself thought to himself that Allah can do nothing against him. This is strange. Really is strange. But anyway, let me now go back to the talk about what has Allah written so that we at least get productive in this. I will not talk about this issue until I cover it out from all angles. Okay? But anyhow, back to our Allah's knowledge. My dear sisters and my brothers, welcome back to part two of what has Allah written. And I will pick up from where I left yesterday about those five man-made hadiths that actually deprive and take away all the freedom that Allah has given us away from our hands. And as I mentioned, that they say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has wiped the back of our father Adam. In another hadith, it's something else. In the third hadith, we were just like there, like ants, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grabbed a bunch of us with his hand, and they say the right hand, and those to paradise, and I don't care. And the rest, he grabbed them with his left, and he said, those to hellfire, I don't care. And of course, they pictured and they painted Allah as this cruel God, like those people that are going to hell fire for eternity. Fir'aun and all those people actually do not deserve to go there, but it is the choice of Allah that made them go there. It actually makes the Qur'an superfluous. Really, in other words, everything that is in Al-Qur'an, all the commands, all the do's, all the don'ts are just a joke, since all is already decided. The fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answers the dua or doesn't, it really means nothing at all, since he already had decided what dua to answer and what dua he doesn't answer. And this makes the entirety of Islam as a total joke, and pictures Allah as a vile God who says something in the Quran when in fact the game has already been sold and the results have already been decided. The five previous or above hadith that I spoke about, those chief hadiths, make the entire of the Quran unnecessary and totally superfluous. Take for example the following promising and hopeful insurance from Allah to humanity when he says in the Quran, قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ. Say, you my subservients who have excessively transgressed against themselves. لا تقنطوا من رحمة الله. Do not despair of the mercy of Allah. Do not lose hope in Allah's mercy. And why all this bounty, Allah? Why don't we despair from your bounty and from your mercy? Because Allah says, إن الله يغفر الذنوب جميعا. Assuredly, certainly, verily, Allah forgives the sins, the lot of them all. إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحُومِ. For he is al-ghafur, i.e. the excessive coverer and hider of all sins, the number, the size, and the weight of those sins, Allah will cover them. And also, what this also means is that Allah nullifies the impact of the sins upon us on Judgment Day. And as if forgiving our sins wasn't enough, Allah throws in further comfort words. And he says, I am Ar-Rahim, i.e. the excessive processes, or the one who gives a lot of hope to his subservient. This is true for somebody who grew up or who committed murder, they're going to be punished by the laws that Allah put on earth, either applied by Allah or directed through religion or through the court of law. But let's say somebody grew up in a very harsh environment and they grew up with the education they have and everything. They got into drugs and they did this. And then one day they do all kinds of sins and everything. Then one day these people feel in their hearts that they want to go back to Allah and they repent and they really feel sorry about this, what they have done, the sins they committed. Well, nobody has the authority to go to these people and tell them, hey, Allah is not going to forgive you, because Allah says to them, do not despair. There is always an opportunity for you to be forsaken, for your sins to be forsaken and forgiven. So as you can see, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promises us something. However, anyone who reads anything other than this ayah will get like the wrong, like stop, the red stop right in your face. Why? Because according to the five man-made hadiths mentioned earlier on, all this is just some sort of a play. Because all is already decided. And those who will benefit out of the Jannah or Allah's forgiveness have their name already chosen. They were lucky enough to be in Allah's light, in that path. You see, believing in the man-made hadith makes the whole thing, really, it drives your belief to contradict the direct teachings of the Qur'an, of what Allah has made in his book. See, the Qur'an being on earth and for us to be on earth along with the Qur'an being test, the concept, all this concept is totally redundant and unnecessary, because the whole thing is just a joke. Just think, take a director, someone who directs a movie in Hollywood. He's written the script just like Avatar. David Cameron. He wrote the script, he had the idea, he looked for the funding, he chose the actors, he did the setup, he worked worked with the computer, the 3D, and what have you. So he is the entire man behind the whole project, right? And then when he makes his movie, he goes to the theater with people and acts like a total dumb that has got no idea of what the movie is all about. And then he gets angry at the actors, and then he feels sorry for the other one, and then he tells people, why is he doing this? And why? And then he blames the actors for behaving in such a way. You know, people are going to turn to him and go, hey, David, it's you. You've written the script, man. You've decided on the actors. You shot the scenes. You edited them. You did everything. Why are you behaving like this? Why are you just like you taking us for stupids or what? Well, exactly the same thing. For us, as Allah has directed the whole thing. He wrote the script. He chose the actors. He chose the scene. He edited. He did everything. And then he puts them in hellfire and gets angry at the actors for doing what he has already decided in the script. My dear sisters and my brothers, what they have made with this hadith is really a crime. If war crimes are punishable throughout the entire world, the religion crimes are far worse. These men hadith have created a very different Islam to what Allah wants in His Quran, and as practiced by His messenger. The messenger, what he practiced when he died, is what Allah wanted, and the messenger never ever left anything behind him from himself to be considered as Islam, but rather he left the Quran as what should be considered as Islam. We have been cheated out of our own destiny, and being cheated of your dreams is very cruel indeed. Any human out there, regardless of their beliefs, hopes greatly on dwelling in the gardens of Eden that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created when they die. You and I are working very hard to make it into paradise. The competition has started, and let the best winner win. And Allah has said this in Al-Quran. فَاسْتَبِقُوا الْخَيْرَاتِ. Just compete with each other to do good deeds to enter paradise. The test had started. But when the idea of your final abode that has already been decided for you is out there and is being preached, that's a very scary thought indeed. Imagine someone already knows where your eternal abode is going to be. And at that very time, he sees you trying your very best. And you do all that you can to please him. And then he does absolutely nothing to save you from that infernal, cursed, and damnable, eternal spot in the most despicable and full of endless torments, hellfire. And all that, with all that, Allah does absolutely nothing to safeguard you from that monstrous and hell-bound scary fate. And then comes the million-dollar question, where is the mercy of Allah in all this? Where is the justice in all this, Ya Allah? Please notice that I am not speaking about people who are merciless, heartless, ruthless villains, who kill at will, people who are part of an international organized crime syndicate, those that sell drugs or that belong to drug cartels, that are murderous and merciless in every corner of each street. I am speaking about you and I. Our mothers, our fathers. I'm speaking about the priest out there who grew up believing that Jesus is Son of God, and that's the only thing he believes in. To him, Jesus being Son of God is as true as for me and you. Allah is alone, single. But that's how he was brought up and everything. Okay, our mothers, again, our mothers, our parents. Yes, you can tell me, well, if this person reads the Bible properly, he will figure out that Jesus is not Son of God. But, well, you too, if you read the Quran properly, I wouldn't feel thirsty until now, trying my very hard to convince you that what the Quran says is the truth. It's the same thing. What applies to them applies to us. And it's very, 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 very sad indeed. Wouldn't you feel totally betrayed if after you spent your entire life doing your very best to make it into Jannah, only to find out on Judgment Day that the deity, the God that you have been worshipping and calling upon all your life to help you achieve the necessary deeds to get into paradise, he knew all along that you're not gonna make it in paradise. Worst, he knew that his light didn't reach you. He knew he didn't grab you with his right hand. Still, he didn't do anything about it. Is Allah like that? Ta'ala Allah. Allah is most high. La ilaha illallah. It's impossible that the Allah of the Quran equals the Allah of the Hadith. But what we believe in more is the Allah of the Hadith. And this is why we don't have a real relationship with Allah. The true love that Allah says in the Quran that we can accomplish is not there. Because the God we worship in, the Allah we worship in, is not the Allah of the Quran. Okay, now I want to get, I'm going to skip a little bit because what I've written is a lot. For example, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Quran says, وَلَا يَرْضَى لِعِبَادِهِ الْكُفْرِ, that Allah does not like it for his subservient to be disbelievers. Yet the hadith says that Allah has written that they be disbelievers, but on the other hand, it tells them that I don't like it for you to be disbelievers. And this kind of thinking gets us in all kinds of problems or contradictions in between the Quran, the Hadith, and this is why you are a Muslim. But you actually don't feel the Islam. It's like a gold rush. We are looking for gold and it's there. We know it's there. The river is there. But you're not enjoying the gold, and this is our problem. Anyhow, the question at hand today is, if Allah has not decided what is going to happen, then what has he written? Is this rule of not deciding what's going to happen, is it general in everything? Or does he get his hand, so to speak, into what's going to happen? Does he affect the future? Okay? Even though Allah has hinted to us in the Quran many things, but these things have been blocked away from us, either because they call them misguidance, deviance, and all those political statements. But here is what we're going to decide today, or talk about at least, is what are those things that Allah wrote? Where did he write that? And also, in what format has he written that, whatever he has written? And the language as well. Can dua alter or fight, manipulate or change or even negate what was written by Allah? Can we use what Allah has written to save our skin on Judgment Day by saying, Ya Allah, we sinned because it was you who had written that on us already, and there was no way away from that except that we sinned because you had binded us, so to speak, to that sin? Can Allah change what he wrote for whatever reason, like he writes something today and tomorrow he changes his point of view or the way he thinks, the way he sees things, and he goes, no, I'll change that? And all these, inshallah, we will deal with them in this particular talk, inshallah. So, but step by step, yeah, because I want to drive the information to you, not drop it as an atomic bomb over you. So step one is that all my researches are done massively on the Quran and the Quran alone. And that's for the following reasons. I've said this before, but it's worth mentioning that here over again. That Allah commanded us in the Quran to only follow the Quran. And also any other that the Quran is politically motivated, and also there is that supremacy agenda that we Muslims have suffered with for 1400 years. And that after 300 years have elapsed, the man-made hadith was invented, and it was invented to contend with Christianity. Because you see, Christianity is built upon the essence of Jesus, son of Mary. And for us Muslims, or at least those, the followers of Muhammad, is that Al-Islam is based, or the center of Al-Islam is on the Quran. But when Muslims mingled with Jews and Christians and other cultures, they found out that the other beliefs, they evolved around a human being, and that's how Al-Islam got shifted from the Quran to hadith, just like Christianity shifted away from the Bible to Christ, so to speak. That's number one. Number two, on Judgment Day, the only book of reference against which Allah will rule is the Qur'an and the Qur'an alone. There will not be the Qur'an and then write with it underneath it, whatever, Bukhari, Muslim, all these things will not. On Judgment Day, is going to be one book and one book alone, and that is the Qur'an. And on Judgment Day, again, the only book that the Messenger of Allah, our Prophet Muhammad, is going to complain against us to Allah for not following it is Al-Quran. On Judgment Day, he's not going to mention Bukhari, Muslim, the sayings of the scholars, the history, the Salaf, whatever you can think of. On Judgment Day, the Prophet Muhammad will just carry one book. And that book is Al-Quran. And that is the book that we follow today to make it safe in this life and in the hereafter. It's absolutely mind-blowing. I tell people what Allah says in the Quran, which is simple, beautiful, just like Allah promised. And people don't believe me because it's too simple, it's too easy. And it beats me to death. But anyhow, point number three, the Quran is the official words of Allah with no human interference. And this is unlike the man-made hadith. I emphasize on using the man-made hadith because that's what they are. The Quran is the official words of Allah. You see, if you work in a company, Company A, and they have the book of rules, if you go and work for another company, you have to apply, you have to work based on the rules of the second company. You can't go to the second company and tell them, oh, I'm working here based on the rules of the previous company. It doesn't work like that. Well, the same thing here. The Quran is the book and it contains everything that we humans need, or at least we believe it, to make it to Al-Jannah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, my dear sisters and my brothers, now that you have established that the Quran as our only source of information and law, let us find out what Allah truly wrote and where He did that. Well, we will also hear at this point here, it's worth mentioning, that we will also finally discover what type of book it is, and above all, the language in which Allah wrote. Believe it or not, Allah said it in the Quran. What language? It's not English, it's not Italian, but you will be surprised when you get to know what language Allah wrote, and also the container book, i.e. the book that contains what Allah has written. And but anyhow, we'll get to that. So my dear sisters and my brothers, Allah mentioned in the Quran that He did write, and He certainly has written something, okay? And He did write it Himself, and He did put it somewhere. And in the Quran, Allah has specified where He wrote whatever He has written. And there are two ayat that Allah has mentioned where He wrote everything that is going to be existing until eternity comes. The first one is an ayah. I've already covered this ayah, but I will again do it another time. And where Allah says, وَمَا مِنْ دَابَّةٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ, and there is not a single moving creature on earth, إِلَّا عَلَى اللَّهِ رِزْقُهَا, but it is upon Allah to provide its sustenance. Now, this is just a small side note, okay? When Allah created the horse, Allah created what the horse feeds on. This is the rizq. When Allah created a shark, Allah at the same time created for the shark what the shark is gonna feed on. When Allah created a human, He created for us what we feed on. This ayah does not mean that you stay home and your rizq has been created for you. No. The rizq, you have to get off the couch and you go out there in the world, fight whatever you need to do to earn your sustenance, to earn your rizq. But what you are going to earn is what Allah has written or has created for us. And then Allah says, وَيَعْلَمُ مُسْتَقَرَّهَا وَمُسْتَوْدَعَهَا, and this creature that Allah created, be you or me or an elephant or some kind of germs that we don't even see, Allah knows where it dwells and where it will permanently rest. When we die, when all that kind of stuff, Allah knows the places where we are going to be stored, not where we are going to die. This is very important, but I will cover this inshallah when I talk about Allah and the future. And then he says, "Kullun fi kitabin mubin." All this that is recorded that you spoke about is in a clear book, kitabin mubin. I.e. that book, when Allah looks into it, it clarifies everything. But that book, you and I, or any human for that matter, or angels or anything, cannot comprehend or encompass all that is in, because it is impossible. Only Allah can do that. So what interests us in this ayah is the closing statement of kullum fi kitabin mubin. All is recorded in a kitab mubin, clarifying book, and very discriminating, i.e. detailed book, with an emphasis on the word kullun. All of what can come to your mind is in that book. Now, the term all means that all creatures, existing data of now, our motion, the sustenance, the place of abode where you sleep at night, and the place of rest, are fully documented, real life, as they occur and not in advance. Meaning, you and I, or that lion in the depth of the savannah, or that killer whale in the depth of the oceans, or any ants or birds in the heavens, or anywhere you think of, they are being watched by Allah real life as they happen. And our entire life is tracked real time. And that the tracking data is documented as it happens in Al-Kitab Al-Mubin, the book or the data book that contains all things that are time and place, space. Just like you have a phone or you have a satellite nav, it tracks every moment of where you are at. The coordinates are always calculated. Well, guess what? The same rule applies. Now, please note that when Allah speaks about the rizq, as I said, he does not mean what you're going to earn. But he has written the money that you are going to earn, and it's entirely up to you. Go, you can earn billions or you can be broke. But that risk, i.e. the money, has been created, and it is up to us to work our tails off and get money. That's why if you decide to do it halal way, it's good for you. And if you decide to do it haram way, do it as you please. Judgment day, Allah takes care of you. The other ayah which features the matter of the creation and the existence data is what Allah says, وَعِنْدَهُ مَفَاتِحُ الْغَيْبِ لَا يَعْلَمُهَا إِلَّا هُوَ. And with him, i.e. with Allah, and he possesses, are the keys of the ghayb. Again, the ghayb is not the future. The ghayb is all that is absent. And only Allah knows the germs inside you. This is an unseen. They exist, but nobody can see them but Allah. Lions in the savannah, again, oceans, everything on earth is ghaib. All that is absent. Because always Allah in the Quran, he uses the verb or the term ghaib against the seen. The unseen against the seen. And he never ever uses it against the past. I.e. ghaib against the past, so that it becomes the future. Okay? وَيَعْلَمُ مَا فِي الْبَرِّ وَالْبَحْرِ. And Allah knows what is in the land and in the sea. وَمَا تَسْقُطُ مِنْ وَرَقَةٍ إِلَّا يَعْلَمُهَا. And whatever leaf falls, except that he knows it. Pay attention. Here Allah says this leaf has to fall for Allah to know it. Not knows when it's going to fall. Okay, وَمَا تَسْقُطُ مِنْ وَرَقَةٍ. And whatever leaf falls, the leaf has to fall. Then Allah knows. And I will deal with this, inshallah, when I talk about Allah and the future. And then he says, وَلَا حَبَّةٍ فِي ظُلُمَاتِ الْأَرْضِ وَلَا رَطْبٍ وَلَا يَابِسٍ. And the same thing, that he is aware of their position, whatever the grains when farmer throws the grains, he doesn't know exactly where his grains are falling. He knows they fall in the field. But Allah knows exactly the coordinates of that grain, either be that in the darkness of the earth or anything green or dry. Allah knows. How does he know that? Because they are tracked real time, and that data is copied straight away. You've guessed it. In Al-Kitab Al-Mubin, in a clarifying book, that book collects the data. You know, just let me give you an example. You'll understand this very well. You know when someone installs a spying application on your phone, that application spies on you 24 hours nonstop. And whatever you do, that application, as it spies, sends it to a server, and the server documents everything that you do. Well, that server becomes the clarifying book, the discriminating, the detailing book that's got everything about you. Well, you've got it now. That's exactly what Allah does. He has this spying data on us, wherever we are, whatever we do, our coordinates, everything is being transmitted real life to a superior book up there with Allah. And it does not necessarily mean a book like you go to the library and buy a book. A book here is a collection. Is theft is there, charity is there, killings are, so it's different chapters, different containers. Now, if you ask a simple person about the meaning of this ayah, they will tell you that Allah is telling us is that he knows everything. He knows the unseen, he knows everything that goes on earth, and nothing escapes his vision. But this is not what Allah is telling us. Since he's told us countless times that he knows it all, but what he really is telling us is something else. The emphasis is on him knowing rather than what will happen. What I mean by this, Allah says things have to happen, he knows them. That's it. And then he documents them as they happen, real life. He never said, what you will do, I will tell you, oh, it's going to be, or it's already been written. It's completely nonsense. Okay? So we have to understand what Allah is telling us. You do an act is being, right now as I talk, the word as it comes out from my mouth is documented. Even if I say half a word and stop, that half word is documented. Okay? Now, before I move to the next ayah, I would like to share with you something very important that needs to be addressed and changed in the Muslim world right now. There was a man whose name was Masruq ibn al-Ajda. This man is a man, okay? He came to Islam in the life of our messenger. May Allah have mercy on him and all his brothers. But was away in Al-Yemen. And as such, this man, Masruq, didn't see the messenger per se. But when he moved to Al-Madinah with his dad, he became a student of our mother, Aisha. And then this man became very, very close with our mother, Aisha. This is what our books say. Okay, I don't believe most of it, but that's what our books of history say, and I will tell you why I don't believe any of this thing. Okay, then because he became very close to her, he gave himself a nickname of Abu Aisha. Today is like infatuated with the woman, but because in the Quran nobody can marry the mothers of the believers, so he decided to give his name or nickname himself Abu Aisha, father of Aisha. In our books of history and all these things, when they spoke about this man and his relationship with the wife of Rasulullah, Aisha, which they described was a red-haired woman with not dark eyes, probably like green eyes or something like that, and she had dimples on her face, so she was extremely attractive. Now, what they did, when they speak about him, they say, أنه من حبه لها تكنى بأبي عائشة. Also, and this is, I'm going to translate here, they say because of his love for her, he nicknamed himself Abu Aisha. Now, this man, now you're going to say, why are you telling us about this man? Well, somehow this man one day found himself alone with our mother Aisha inside her house, alone. A man totally infatuated with our mother, wife of Rasulullah, and he finds himself alone. Didn't she know about the khulwa? Didn't he know about the khulwa? I don't know. That's why I don't believe in this. To me, it just defies gravity, so to speak. Okay? But let's carry on. Okay? So this man was, he said, one day sitting with Aisha. But he said now, and this hadith is in al-Bukhari, it's in authentic. My head is giving me a headache just thinking about the atrocity of what the, and the scholars don't see a problem with that. A Muslim woman can't go outside of her door, but for our mother Aisha to be with a complete stranger man who completely smitten with her, so much so that he named himself after her, alone in a house, that's fine. No big deal. Hey, you know what? But anyhow, but so this man here was talking to our mother Aisha, and she said to him, Abu Aisha, so she knew that his name is Abu Aisha on her. Well, again, there are three things, and he who affirmed even one of them has fabricated the greatest lie against Allah. So this man, Masruq, asked what they are. What are these three things that if you affirm them, if you accept them, if you agree to them, you then have formulated a great lie? قَدْ افْتَرَى عَلَى اللَّهِ فِرْيَةً. Firya is when you invent a lie altogether. And then he said, he was sitting, he was laying down, and when she said this, he sat up. She said, he who presumes that Muhammad saw his Lord has fabricated the greatest lie against Allah. Because at the early days of Islam, at the time of the companions, there were people who exaggerated on the Messenger of Allah. They said he saw Allah, just like you. But anyhow, so whoever says that the Prophet Muhammad saw Allah, then this guy has invented a huge lie against Allah. And again, he was reclining, then he said, I sat up and said, Mother of the faithful, Mother of the believer, wait a bit. Do not be in haste. Now, this is a man talking to the wife of Rasulullah, who tells him whoever says that, whoever saw, that the Prophet Muhammad saw Allah, he has invented a huge lie. And this man opposes this because there were a great number of people back in time, at the time of the messenger, that people thought that the Prophet saw Allah with his own eyes. It's crazy. It totally is crazy. But anyhow, and then he said to her, has not Allah said, and truly he saw him on the clear horizon? And he's referring here to Surah Al-Takwir in the Surah number 81 and the Ayah 23. And to another Surah where he says, and he saw him in another descent. وَلَقَدْ رَآهُ نَزْلَةً أُخْرَى وَلَقَدْ رَآهُ بِالْأُفُقِ الْمُبِينِ. And again, the second one is Surah Al-Najm, that is 53 and the Ayah 13. She said, I was the first of this ummah, us who believe in Prophet Muhammad, who asked the Messenger of Allah about it, about seeing she mentioned now. And he said to her that it was about Jibreel, the Jibreel alayhi salam. For your information, you're going to be shocked now. I'm going to tell you something else that's going to shock you. Jibreel is not an angel. Jibreel is not an angel. There are the angels, there is Allah, there are angels, there are the jinn, there are humans, there are things. Jibreel is not an angel. Jibreel is a Holy Spirit. And Allah says this, and you can even recite it in Surah Inna Anzalnahu Fi Laylatil Qadr. Doesn't Allah says تَنَزَّلُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ وَالرُّوحُ, that the angels and the Holy Spirit descend in it? Because if he was part of the angels, then Allah would have said the angels. But because Jibreel alayhi salam is different than the angels, but anyhow, let's not get out. I'll talk about this, inshallah, when I get to the angels in Al-Quran, and you'll be amazed about this beautiful world of those beautiful creatures. But anyhow, and then she said that it was Jibreel alayhi salam. She further added, Have you not heard Allah saying, eyes comprehend him not, but he comprehends all vision, and he is subtle and all aware. La tudrik al-absar, wa huwa yudrik al-absar. This is in Surah Al-An'am, Surah 6, Ayah 103. Then she further says, have you not heard that verily Allah says, and it's not for any human being that Allah should speak to him except by revelation or from behind a partition, or that he sends a messenger to reveal by his permission what he wills. Indeed, he is the most high and wise. And this is Surah Ash-Shura 42:51. Number two. Now that's number one. Number two, she said, he who presumes that the messenger of Allah concealed anything from the book of Allah fabricates the greatest lie against Allah. Then she recites some Quran to this effect. Remember, she recites some Quran to this effect. Number three, and this is what matters to us. He who presumes that the messenger of Allah would inform about what was going to happen tomorrow fabricates the greatest lie against Allah. For Allah says in the Quran, and she says this in Arabic, but I say it in English, say, none in the heavens, لا يعلم الغيب في السماوات والأرض إلا الله. Say, none in the heavens and earth knows the unseen except Allah, and they do not perceive when they will be resurrected. And this ayah is Surah An-Naml 27 and the ayah 65. And this hadith is in Muslim and At-Tirmidhi. This shows, my dear sisters and my brothers, that all those futuristic hadiths have nothing to do with the messenger, because according to our the Quran in the first place, and then according to our mother Aisha, anyone that claims that the messenger knows what's going to happen tomorrow has fabricated the greatest lie against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So now you understand, my dear sisters and my brothers, the importance of Allah writing the future and us only like a script for a Hollywood movie. The script is already written, the scenarios are already there, the scenes are already, the camera's already there, and we just follow a script. If the script has something wrong in it, why do we blame the actor? It's the script, the problem. So claiming that Allah has already written everything is the hugest lie that humanity has been subjected to since the time where Musa alayhi salam came until our time. And the Quran was supposed to correct all these wrong stuff, but the manipulation of humans has ensured that we Muslims carried on the same errors as the Jews and Christian. In a man-made hadith collected by Al-Bukhari, it is reported that Abdullah ibn Umar mentioned that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, مَفَاتِحُ الْغَيْبِ لا يعلمها إلا الله. الغيب, the unseen. What reveals the unseen is only known to Allah. And there are five things that have been mentioned in Surah Luqman. Surah Luqman is the surah number 31, and the ayah they're talking about is the ayah 34 at the end of Surah Luqman, where they claim that Allah has said that only Allah knows five things, and these are the core of the unseen. Okay, number one, they said that the only one to know what is in the womb of mothers is Allah. Allah never said that, but anyhow. لا يعلم ما في غد إلا الله, that the only one that knows what's in tomorrow is only Allah. Number three, that the only one to know when the rain is going to fall is Allah. And that's why we have scholars even in Saudi Arabia. And today they say anyone that says tomorrow is going to rain, okay, without saying inshallah is a kafir, regardless of the science. And I don't want to get... Number four, لا تدري نفس بأي أرض تموت إلا الله, that the only one that knows when a soul shall die is Allah. And this is also untrue. Because if any of these things, if one, for example, can say where they're going to die, then this ayah is no longer valid. And I can bring 100 people that do that. For example, someone who has been jailed and man they're going to be executed, capital death, for a murder. And they tell him, you're going to be executed on the 26th of March at 5 o'clock. And they gave him in state Arizona, in the jail in Arizona. Comes that day, guess what? The person is executed. The person knew when he was going to be executed. The judge knew, the police knew, the department, the hospital knew, everybody knew. So that means if Allah says that only Allah knows that and humans can say, then this ayah is not valid. But of course, this is not what Allah says. Go review the ayah, read it from, clear your mind, read it from an angle, not an agended angle. That means you approach the ayah with an agenda, but out of, like, read it. Allah is telling you one thing. Read it and see what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says. Of course, the man-made hadith and the collected hadith, they are absolutely wrong. We humans have advanced, and there are predictions and accurate predictions made all the time. What makes this statement so wrong is at any one time, if one human could know one of those five things that they claim only Allah knows them, then that's it. It runs the Qur'an invalid. And it's not true at all. More alarming and more serious is the fact that those men of religion in the past have issued statements that if any person claims to know any of the fives that I mentioned, is a kafir. Subhanallah, it's incredible. I will stop here because it's past an hour, and in part three, inshallah, we carry on. Obviously, it took a long time, but there is a lot to change perception, to think, connect you with the Qur'an, help you become more trusting in Al-Qur'an and accept that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala what's in the Qur'an is truly Al-Islam. Okay? And inshallah, in the next talk number three, we'll go back inshallah and start straight away with Al-Kitab Al-Mubin, the clarifying book or the discriminating book, and gradually we'll get to the what knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and all that stuff, inshallah. We should be able to dig right in next talk, inshallah. I pray to Allah that my talk finds place in your heart and that the image now or the picture is getting clearer. And until part number three, be in the mercy of Allah. Again, this is your brother Abdussalam Abu Hanifa. I hope to see you soon. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.